Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening to everyone who's taken the time to join us today from across the world. Thank you very much for being with us today. I'm just going to take a minute to introduce myself and the network who's hosting today and say a little bit about today's event, and then we'll get straight into our speakers. So my name is Sonia Jenkins, and I'm the Network Development Manager for the World Technology Universities Network, also known as WTUN, because that's a lot easier to say. For those of you who don't know and who haven't worked with WTUN before, we are a network of over 20 technology universities from across the globe who are committed to undertaking cutting-edge, challenge-led research with direct benefit to people and society, and also providing education for the next generation of global citizens who'll have to respond to the world's 21st century challenges. As a network, we have many objectives, but some of these include to promote a better understanding of the role and the characteristics of technology universities across the world. We look to promote mobility and global citizenship opportunities, to collaborate on research and knowledge transfer to address global challenges, and also to share best practice, which is exactly what we're doing here today. Our primary network-wide activities involve staff and student exchanges, collaborative research across members, competitions for students to get involved in, and also an annual congress. But we also have work streams in innovation and entrepreneurship, gender equality within higher education, and also the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which all have their own set of activities. Now, we could not be a network that says that they address 21st century challenges and ignore the current global COVID-19 pandemic, which has in some shape or form affected all of our lives. It is because of COVID-19 that I am currently working from my spare bedroom, which is why you can see my husband's appreciation of cricket in the background. So the network felt that it was very important that we address the current situation somehow, and through conversations with our operational board, which features representatives from all of our members, it became evident that a series of webinars showing exactly how technology universities have worked through the current situation would be the best way to share best practice. Today's webinar is titled Online Learning and Teaching, Lessons Learned from COVID-19. And I'm very excited that we're delivering today's event in partnership with one of our founding members, Alia University. Our keynote speaker today is Professor Mansour Al-Ali, who is president of Alia University. And he will be joined on the panel by Mr. Guido Capel, who is the managing director of the Center of Knowledge Management at Ham-Lippstadt University of Applied Sciences, another one of our founding members, and also Assistant Professor Rosemary McIlwain, Assistant Professor of Learning and Teaching Enhancement at Heriot Watt University, also a founding member of WTUN. I hope you will all join me in welcoming them to today's event. In terms of how today's event will work, we'll hear from all of our panel members in turn about their experiences at their institutions, and then there will be an opportunity for questions to the panel at the end. Please type your questions and comments into the Q&A box for them to be submitted, and we will try to answer as many as we can. So I would like to start today's session by handing over to Professor Mansour. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, Sonia. Can you see my slides now? Can you see my slides?
Yes, Professor. F5, yeah.
Yes, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody, wherever you are in the world. Welcome to Ahliya University, welcome to WTUN. I must thank Sonia and her team at WTUN and Bradford University. And I must thank our team here at Ahliya for hosting this very important event. Let me start, first of all, by giving you an overview of Bahrain and higher education in Bahrain. As you can see on the left, Bahrain is a country of so many islands. It's a number of islands in the Gulf. Its rough area is about 770 square kilometers, and the population is roughly 1.3 million. So we are a small country, but we are strategically placed in the Gulf, and Bahrain is building a reputation as a host for excellent higher education, and hence trying to attract regional students from the GCC and from around the world. We have two public universities and we have 14 private universities. These universities are regulated by the Higher Education Council, HEC, and the Bahrain Quality Assurance Agency, who validate and assess the delivery of higher education in Bahrain in the form of quality assurance aspects and the national qualification framework, which places qualifications at the right level. What you will see in this picture is the Ahliya University was established in 2001, and you will see on the in the picture on the right, His Royal Highness, the Prime Minister, laying the foundation stone for Ahliya University, and there on his on this side here is our founding president, Professor Abdul Hawaj, which was really a major event to lay the foundation stone of this university. The design of the university on the left-hand side, you can see it's like a folding book. It was designed by AECOM, the world's leading architecture company. The red spot here, that's where Ahliya University will be. These are 14 islands claimed from the sea, reclaimed from the sea by the government of Bahrain to house about 100,000 citizens. We are the only university located in this island number 10, and you can see the sea is all around us, and on your left is the mainland. Let me first of all, before I go into the generalities, give you the history, the milestones of what happened here in Bahrain and what happened at Ahliya and how we reacted to it. What did we do? It was a shock to everybody, a shock to all of us. So if I take you through the steps or the milestones that took place here in Bahrain, on the 21st of February, the first COVID-19 case was found in Bahrain. On the 25th of February, face-to-face teaching was suspended by the government. On the 26th of February, we delivered the first online lecture, so the next day, and that gives you an idea that the technology was there and we were ready more or less for it, although we did not deliver online lectures before. Again, on the 27th of February, there was a major management meeting to propose solutions. What do we do? There was no decision, you know, as to what to do next. And our current legislation or the legislation before the coronavirus was that online teaching was not on the agenda. On the 1st of March, all lectures were shifted to online mode. On the 11th of March again, we launched the first web page for COVID-19. So our students, all stakeholders, our faculty, it became a focal and a reference point to everybody associated with the university. On the 16th of March, Ahliya University formed what we called Ahliya COVID Steering Committee. This is from the senior management to oversee the whole process of transformation from face-to-face to online and with all its implications, and to make sure that the process runs smoothly and the right support is readily available. On the 22nd of March, we created Ahliya Call Center. Why? Because a lot of students and faculty had a lot of questions, and which the website sometimes wasn't enough. They wanted somebody to talk to, and it was really a good idea that we established it. On the 22nd of March again, we issued a decision about flexible working hours for staff and faculty. So we allowed staff to work from home. Up to 70% of the staff, we allowed them to work from home. And faculty, we gave them the choice to come and teach from Ahliya, or if they have the right setup at home, we monitor that, we check it, that they can deliver their lectures from home. On the 24th of March, in order to assess how the process is going, we developed the first student survey to assess online teaching and learning, and it was delivered to students, and some analyses were done later. On the 1st of April, we had to face the difficult issue. Students are studying from home. Lectures were being delivered online. then how do we assess the students? What kind of grading do we give? How do we trust the assessments? So the university took a decision to give the students the option either to opt for a pass and fail a grade or to take an exam with a normal grade. So that at first, in the first instance, most students opted for pass-fail. As we progressed, as online teaching and learning developed, students became more confident. Slowly, some of them wanted to go to the grade because they needed the grade maybe for a variety of reasons. On the 10th of April, again, we conducted a faculty survey to assess how the faculty are feeling, their well-being, how are they feeling about online teaching, where do they think are the weak points, where are the strong points. So again, that was conducted and analyzed. On the 19th of April, we conducted the second student survey, and to our amazement, we noticed there was a lot of confidence that has been built into the students. They feel more comfortable now. They feel more confident. They can relate to the lectures online. Still some little difficulties here and there, and some little hiccups in general, mostly to do with technology and sometimes to do with the environment. And we assessed that in order to deal with it. And that was a very vital action to take. It helped us a lot. On the 21st of April, Ahliya University, you know, there was His Highness Sheikh Nasser launched this charity where, you know, people can donate to the people in Bahrain who are affected by the coronavirus through whatever purpose. And Ahliya decided to donate $25,000 to this charity. And it was actually in Arabic, it was called Fina Khair, which means there is goodness in all of us. That's what it means. On the 23rd of April, Ahliya University, trying to assess its situation, trying to help society as part of its society and corporate social responsibility, decided that all the sons and daughters of frontline workers and the frontline workers themselves will be given 50% discount when they enroll in Ahliya. Frontline workers means the medical staff, people in the army and military, all those associated directly with the public. That was as help from Ahliya, and it received a great appreciation from the public. On the 20th of May, the president met with a number of students, about 30 students, face-to-face, online, to see, for selected from different programs to see how they are. And on the 4th of June, we started a series of forums and online conferences, and we run the first international online forum. We call it Education Excellence Sustainability. It was participants or speakers were from Europe and different parts of the world. That was just a summary of the milestones which took place at Ahliya. Let me now tell you about the assumptions in transforming face-to-face to online teaching and learning. One of our shocks and amazement that we noticed that this transformation process put demand on the management. The way of thinking has changed. The way we are dealing with things has changed. The whole environment has changed. That required a lot of monitoring, a lot of management decisions. And that entails a lot of cost and planning. So cost and planning took place to alleviate some of the fears or some of the obstacles or some of the difficulties. On the left-hand side, you will see I have three major elements or categories. The very first major assumptions that were made by us and most universities across the world is the issue of assessments. We are used to giving exams and assignments. People do exams here face to face. The concept of continuous assignment was raised. And what does that mean? How often? How regular? the incremental assignment, where you make the assignments go in difficulty, slowly become more difficult, so you give more confidence. Instrumental assignments, where one assignment is an instrument doing another. And I think the most challenging point of them all was meaningful assignments or assessments. How can you be sure the assessment you are giving to the student makes sense, it is not plagiarized, that it is marked correctly? These are real assumptions which had to be tackled, and meetings took place in how to deal with this. The second assumption or challenge that we had to deal with was the issue of the skills. We are used to delivering skills and teaching skills to students when they are face to face. Let me take the practical skills. How do you do it online? Certain analytical skills when discussions take place, and research skills and soft skills. And I'll tell you something here. Some of the students at home, they feel shy to switch the cameras on because of whatever reasons, certain environments. They feel a bit, they don't feel confident enough. So these are issues, or these were issues, and they are still in progress. We are still tackling them, how to deal with them. And hence, in the next semester in September, we are moving more towards blended learning, where courses with practical elements will be maybe delivered on campus. You know, every course has ILOs, every program has ILOs. The ILOs, when you're teaching online, can you really be confident your assessments and your teaching are matching this, and they are really, the knowledge is being delivered in all its forms, and you are really assessing it properly, and you are meeting the ILOs, graduate attributes, and the different skills? Yes, we have discussed it. We have gone a long way, but I still think there is room for improvement, and we are working on it. On the right hand side, the issues of student environment. You know, how calm is the environment at home? How motivated they are when they come to campus? They're motivated by watching each other. Then we have to look into that. We have to find ways of motivating them. How confident they are. And we realize some of them, you know, build confidence being around their colleagues. They are now quiet in their home. We don't know what environment they're in. Certain tools that they use here naturally and normally, now maybe they don't have them at home. And the question we will ask ourselves as a university, what support should we give to these students? What kind of support? When do we give this support? How do we know the students who need support? These are major questions that we've been working on, and we're still working on, and thank God we are really progressing. We never ignored the faculty, because the faculty is our main, the pivotal factors in a university. We realized that some of the faculties weren't familiar with some of the tools. They required a lot of training and a lot of support. Some of them were not confident how to teach. You know, when you teach face to face, you can raise your voice, you can have eye contacts, you monitor students' movement. But when you don't see the students, when students don't put their cameras on, and even when they put the cameras on, they see little dots here and there. How do you deal with them? How do you deal with people fidgeting and moving or not listening? How do you know they're listening? They could simply silence or mute the mic. So that's why we conducted surveys to assess the faculty environment and to give them the right support. And we've noticed that the confidence of faculty has gradually progressed, and they became more and more confident. To our amazement, in the first glance, we assumed all the policies of Ahliya, and they are in the hundreds, they were suitable. Slowly but surely, we realized, no, they are not as, we need to modify them. The teaching styles and teaching methods, they had to be slightly modified. The assessment policies had to be modified. The support policies, the activities, the performance evaluation policies, the conduct policies, the infrastructure policies. a wide number of policies were not matching 100%. So we had to restudy them, sit down and consider them and map them to the new environment. There is now a new environment. It's a shock, but it's a new environment. Technology is here, but we realize technology fills a gap, but does not provide all the that's required. It does not support all the vision and mission that we need to achieve. So just to give you some of the things we've been looking at Tahlia here, I called it stakeholders' well-being. We wanted to know, does the commitment change, faculty experience and commitment? How do we study it? How committed they are to online? The communication issues, before, you know, you send an email or you meet somebody in the corridor or you phone them, now the people are at home. How do you deal with them? How do you communicate with them? And we utilize all available technologies. Comprehensive faculty, student, and comprehensive faculty and student support was developed slowly but surely. We were given more and more support. We had to assess and evaluate the readiness of faculty and students and to measure their acceptance of e-learning. Some people objected. You know, what does it mean I watch my professor on camera on a screen? What is this? I did not go to university to be faced with this kind of environment. And we had to build that kind of acceptance in them. We had to find ways. And one of them here, I remember the chairman of the Board of Trustees, Professor Abdullah, sending a message, a heartwarming message to all the students to give them comfort. Building that experience, learning online experience in the students, how do you make sure that all the time they're building better experience? The issue of health and safety also was of significance to us. You know, we don't see the students. Are they stressed? Some students were stressed. Some of the students were fearful. Before we took the decision of the pass and fail option, students were fearful and scared of what is next. And they wanted to drop or delay their studies. Equality, gender and special needs. You know, I don't know if you know this, but Ahliya University in Bahrain is well known as the university, the friendly university for special needs. We admit a large number of special needs and we give them a lot of attention. So how do we make sure they have the right environment and they are getting equal support and equal opportunities when they are at home? That was one of the issues to be considered. And the last point in this slide is the issue of finance. I mentioned Ahliya University gave 50% discount to all frontline workers and to their offsprings. But Ahliya also, as support, gave 5% discount to all students as a general charity move or a general help move. And as I said, we funded this Fina Khair charity with 10,000 Bahraini dinars or $25,000. This is to show society that Ahliya cares. This is to show society that Ahliya is part of society. This is to show society that we are here, not as educators only, but we as members of society. And I'm happy to inform you that received a lot of appreciation. In this well-being issue also, the counseling, we have a directorate for counseling and advising. Before, you know, we call the student to the office and they talk to them, what's your problem, whether it's a social problem, an academic problem, and they have a chat and try to guide the student to progress better. Students who are remotely dealing with studying and they're not here, how do you identify them? And when you identify them, these are students who are at risk. How do you deal with them? How do you give them the privacy? How do you record the meetings? How do you make sure they listen to you? This was a challenge and we learned from the slowly but surely we learned from that concept and I'm glad we have done it. We allowed in our complaint systems to receive complaints and we dealt with them and we have a student support officer to deal with that. The continuous evaluation of satisfaction was across board. We want everybody to be evaluated and to measure their satisfaction. Only through that we know how to progress and develop. If we pretended everything is rosy, then we will be lost at the end. As I said, online assessments presented fears in students' hearts, and we tried to alleviate these fears slowly but surely. And I mentioned about the grading, which once the decision was taken, students were kind of breathe a sigh of relief, and they were a bit more relaxed, and they progressed a bit better. Now, in this slide, I'll talk about tuning to online change and technology. Every university, there is a jungle of technologies out there. There is a jungle of softwares. There is competition between technological companies. Everybody is trying to sell you the software. It is a bit confusing. What do you stick to? What is the right software? What is the right tool? Which is the best tool for teaching online? Which one has the best features? Which one is more, has a better interface? We used Teams at the end, but there are others. We used some faculty to communicate with their students through WhatsApp. Now, there are many communication tools for that. We had to move online because our lectures and a lot of things went cloud. The cloud is now the major platform. The technical support, how do you provide it, through which means? What do you put on the website and what is the right form? The call center itself, you know, what kind of technology do you use? Do you automate certain things? Do you automate frequently asked questions? Or do you have, you know, a person sitting there? How do we use the Facebook? Is it just social media now, or is it teaching media? You realize between social media and teaching media now there is vagueness. I think most media become most media available has become teaching media. Even SMS was used, Skype for Business, Outlook, Moodle. Ahliya standardized on Moodle, because we have a lot of experience in Moodle. All our courses are Moodle. We can do a lot of Moodle. Moodle proved itself. I know there are others out there like WebCity. So we standardized for the teaching part on Moodle and Teams. But we utilized the others wherever possible. So when it comes to tuning online change and technology, there are certain issues that one must consider. The first one is the issue of infrastructure, the IT infrastructure for learning. Because of the complexity of this process, because of the wide variety of available tools, what do you standardize on? Then the next point is online teaching and assessment tools. What are the choices? Which tools you do, and how do you guarantee plagiarism is minimized? So some mechanisms we have to think of that. Even the time given to an assignment or an assessment or an exam had to be considered. Legislations. You know, we are bound by legislations from the Higher Education Council and the Bahrain Quality Assurance Agency. These legislations were not geared for online teaching and learning. We had to adapt. We were running a bit fast, and they were coming later with some suggestions and legislation. So we have to meet somewhere. We have to have a meeting point together. And inshallah, hopefully by next semester, we will have a meeting point, a common meeting ground. The concept of monitoring, how do we know before when, if a lecturer is absent, or a lecturer cuts the lecture into half, or he comes to his lecture late? How do we monitor these things? How do we monitor the attendance of students? So we went a long way trying to create the policies and tools and mechanisms to monitor the teaching and to monitor and record attendance. Only a few days ago we had in the strategic planning committee, we were trying to discuss and measure the impact of this COVID-19 on Ahliya's strategy and achieving its objectives. Was there an impact? Yes, there was. Did we adapt to it? Yes, we did. But still there is an impact which we are trying to reduce all the time. The issue of continuity and stability is always in our minds. You know, it's always scary thing. You know, can we continue? Are we ready? But all the time we are thinking and trying to plan and improve our situation. And it's proving successful. I just want to give you selected statistics, which from the second semester in 2019-2020, the semester where coronavirus hit every country of the world. We conducted 275 courses were successfully delivered online, fully developed online. 12,315 online class and lab sessions were conducted by our faculty at Ahliya. To our amazement, a very small number of students, only 10 students decided to withdraw in that semester because they were fearful. We expected more, but because of the hard work we put, only few have actually withdrawn. Out of all our students, we conducted 93 final exams and a lot of them opted for pass and fail. So, you know, the option served us a little bit. Some dissertations were postponed, but a lot of dissertations were conducted online and they proved successful. Actually, there was a lot of benefit in the online dissertation vivas or defenses that we were able to use external examiners from around the world, wherever they are, and they can conduct the viva. So it helped us a lot. No visa, no trouble, no headache. Moodle was really put to its full swing. We had 8,000 logins per day on average in Moodle. Using Microsoft Teams group calls, there was 10,700 group calls. And we conducted at Ahliya in semester two, 4,361 meetings, all on Teams, all using Teams. So it was business as usual, business as usual. Actually, we realized there are opportunities. Around the world, they're talking about economic opportunities, financial opportunities, etc. But we realized there was a lot of opportunities. So we did not hold back. We conducted conferences, symposiums, webinars. One of the very first major international conference or forum we conducted was called Education Excellence Sustainability. We conducted two of these and we were planning for the third. We conducted a meeting between industry and the university-industry interface during COVID-19. And here we had CEOs from major Bahraini companies, industrial companies. We conducted a major conference on interior design, the impact of COVID-19 on interior design. Community engagement and social responsibility during COVID-19 was yet another forum by leading people in Bahrain and around the Gulf. We conducted an online master symposium. A lot of college webinars and seminars were conducted, and a lot of Ahliya community engagement activities, educating society about COVID-19 were conducted. So Ahliya fulfilled its role during this period, and we learned a lot of lessons. To conclude, because I think I've taken almost half an hour, I have a lot to say, but I just want to conclude by saying, in Ahliya, how do we see our future considerations? What are our future considerations? I think they are common to all universities. What are we going to do to deal with the situation, whether it's going to be blended or fully online? I think one of the major things that have to be looked at, which we have, there's still room for improvement, is the policies. I think every university should revisit its policies and gear it towards online. It has to map. I think the teaching methods and teaching qualities have to be considered. And I think some guidelines have to be produced. We have produced some guidelines, and I think we need to develop them further. Teaching online, a bit like how I'm speaking to you now, I don't see you, I'm speaking to a slide. So it's a bit challenging. I don't even know if my voice sounds good or not, or sounds loud enough. There is a lot of talk and a lot of webinars about teaching methods. Some people will tell you, okay, you speak for 3 minutes and ask questions. Some people will tell you many things. So it is an area for research, an area for improvement. I expect there will be an impact on finance and budgeting because of this COVID-19. Thankfully, at Ahliya, we are okay with it, but it has to be considered. One of the challenging next points in our future considerations, if blended learning is allowed, what is the ratio? Which courses should be face-to-face? And why? Some people will argue, well, you can teach me online. Why do I have to travel and use my car and spend petrol and waste money? And you know, why? You can teach me. Why don't you teach me online? So I think I anticipate in the future there'll be an argument for online rather than against online, in my view. And I think this is what we are noticing anyway. The next future consideration is the issue of recognition of degrees. Locally here in Bahrain, our legislations until now does not recognize online degrees. This has been softened a little bit. I think there is more acceptance, and hopefully in the future there will be recognition at least with blended learning. I know in the US especially, a lot of universities are conducting online teaching, fully online degrees, and these are leading the universities, major universities. Not, you know, other rated universities. I think we should continue to look at student and faculty well-being and find better ways of making our students more confident, more motivated, more comfortable. And the same thing goes for our faculty. We are looking into that. The more you make your faculty and students at ease, the more you make them motivated, you make them confident, you provide them with the right tools, the right technology, the right methods of teaching, then the process will be successful. It's a challenge, but I think we are heading in the right direction. Another thing is the issue of international collaboration. I mean, some of our French exchange students, because of the COVID-19, left. Some stayed, some left. Now, in the future, if COVID-19 continues, will exchange students continue? Will international visits continue? Obviously, that is something we don't know about. And, you know, to conclude, and as my final point, the issues, the difficulties in the choice of technology, difficult choices with technology. I anticipate that technology companies and software companies will work so hard, and we've seen some fast changes. Teams have, for example, presented this classroom environment only last month. I anticipate a lot of money will be invested in technology and software to enable better online teaching and learning, to enable better online teaching environment, to give a better interface, and to make life more comfortable. I want to thank you all for bearing with me for a full 30 minutes. I want to thank WTUN and our Ahliya staff who have contributed to hosting this event. And I wish you all the best of luck. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Sonia.
Thank you so much, Professor Mansour. It's great to see just how quick Ahliya reacted to this entire situation and just how much detail you've gone into when looking at the impact that this is going to have on your staff and students. I just want to remind everyone that the question and answer panel is open, so please do submit your questions and we will put them to the panel at the end of all of our presentations. So now I'm going to hand over to Mr. Guido Kippelt from Ham-Lippstadt University of Applied Sciences, so he can tell us about his experiences in Germany. Thank you.
Okay, so did everyone see my slides? Hello?
Yeah, you're good to go.
Yeah?
Yep.
Okay. So, hello everybody. My name is Guido Kippelt. I'm the Managing Director of the Center of Knowledge Management at the University of Applied Science Hamm-Lippstadt. What is the Center of Knowledge Management? It is a central unit at the university, and it includes four units: the information technology, the library, the e-coordination, what is called for e-learning unit, and the language service. So I want to divide my my presentation into two points. The first point is our system landscape and e-content. So what we do in the COVID-19 time, and what was developed in the past. So first of all, we are responsible for digital support of all learning and teaching processes, and our head portal is myHSHL. HSHL is the acronym of Hochschule Hamm-Lippstadt, so we called it myHSHL because every student have the feeling, okay, this is my entry into my university. So what you see here is self-development. It's not a software we write. So we develop it with the provider, and the points you see is email, campus office online, and the library account, and also we call it in Germany the Lernplattform, the learning management system. The learning management system, we use also Moodle, and we have another self-developed software behind it. We call it group management. So every course we have here in reality, we have a counterpart in virtual reality with all the members. And so we use it really with really high usage of it, and we have in the past really high peak utilization peaks. So we decided at the end of the year 2019, to build it up and to give him more resources, and we completed this in February 2020. It was very lucky at this time, because if you see the statistics of the logins, I think it is a little bit like Mr. Mansour told us. We have the highest logins at the 26th April of 2020, yes, with 55,000. We have 6,000 students, so it is I think a good number of logins. So and you see here the views of everything what is in the learning management system, and also the activities. So this is our core heart of the learning tools, but we have a big problem, and so we needed a video conference system, because in Germany we have the DFN, the German Research Network, who gives us these services. I think somebody knows this software, Adobe Connect and Pexip. And these services were in the COVID time not usable because every university wants to use it. And so there was really big performance problems. So we must decide to do something on our own. So we have 2 days to make a decision, and we take this conference system Big Blue Button. Big Blue Button is an open source product who can be integrated in Moodle. That was really important for us, and also because of the open source character. We put it in. We need 1.5 months to build it up, and to build up our also a high performance server cluster. First of all, we used only one server, and that was really hard at time for my staff members because there was a lot of calls of the performance of this system. So what we do with this, the usage scenarios are live lectures, live seminars, and live tutorials. And you can use this software to divide it seminars into breakout rooms, and you can divide the moderation and so on. So here you can see numbers, how much meetings, you see it here. It's only a scale from the 7th of May to 25th of May, but you see meetings parallel 63, and members of the meetings maximum is 628. Yes, and what is another part of our landscape? We're using also a video content management system. It is Panopto. And in the past, we have a really low usage rate. The teachers are not really interested in this system. We mainly used it for and by students with chronic illness and need for assistance. People who have to watch their children or something. It also is integrated in the learning management system Moodle. But during the online semester, the COVID-19 times, we had a rapid increase of the usage. And you see here in the screenshot, it is integrated in the learning management system. It's all it's a little button you click and you put your lecture in. What is the usage scenario? It is the recording of lectures and of tutorials. So here you see the usage numbers. In the past, it was the highest usage in the past. It was the winter semester 18-19. And you see we have a number of calls, totally 3,256 and average user per week, 7, maximum 56. Also you see very low. And if you see the numbers of usage now, it's very different. Yes, we have minutes displayed over 20.5 million, a number of calls of 158,000, and a maximum average user per week of 2,000. Another point was to help the teachers was the acquisition of e-content. We have a lot of content the teachers uses who is physically in the libraries, and so we must buy a lot of e-content And there are very various in the form of the acquisition. Yeah, we have a temporary, permanent. We have something we've bought, something we've licensed, and we also have diverse formats, yes? Like ebooks, e-journals, videos. So these are all points of the of the systems landscape, I would say. But what is really important for me to say is that to see the human factor, I told it, because we made the experience that our staff was the important factor in this whole process of COVID-19. I made this little mathematical systems plus consulting is a result as an effective and qualitative e-learning courses. For example, we have consulting services and webinars through our e-coordinators, and they have in these times of COVID-19 over 500 tickets. We have a ticket system for these e-coordinations. And they are so famous that they get mails to their personally named addresses, and there was of about 650 mails. So what did they do? They made introductory events about the individual services and so on, and informative meetings to broaden the knowledge. And also the teachers want to make now a regular exchange of information about all these e-learning things and all these systems I told before. So what will I say as a conclusion? For one point, it is very important to have a functioning systems landscape for students and for teachers, and you need a systems provider who make an adequate technical support. But also we check out that these various scenarios of teaching need different services.